The majority of your questions on step one are going to be patient-centered questions. That should be contrasted to subject-centered learning. Subject-centered learning says microbiology, anatomy, histology, physiology. A patient-centered question starts with the discussion of a clinical encounter. A 58-year-old woman presents to her doctor with, and there's a reason for that. All of clinical reasoning is based on this idea of a chief complaint from which you can form a differential diagnosis. If you think you're going to take your subject-based learning, microbiology, anatomy, physiology, and you're going to figure out which elements you now need in that question to do differential diagnosis, you've set yourself a very large mountain to climb, my friend. Instead, why don't you just start with the chief complaint and learn your medicine through the pathophysiology of differential diagnosis? I've done this for many students and they all come back and go, well, that was easy. If you learn your medical information through this idea of starting with a chief complaint, it has the infinite benefit that you're now approaching every question the same way practicing physicians approach them. And it's a clinical exam. So suddenly, you're seeing the question the same way as the person who wrote it. So every week we're going to be posting basically about my life. And my life is fundamentally teaching students. And so it's going to include all kinds of things. I write lots of questions. I'm always being surprised by things I learn. I'll share that. I'm always interacting with the students I teach. They always ask questions that astound me. I'm going to share those. Some of them are funny. Some of them are actually really insightful. I talk to colleagues. They all have new insights. So every week we're going to be doing new videos about my life teaching. And from it, you're going to get this deep insight into how the people who write your exams think and talk and learn. And it puts you absolutely sympathetically in touch with what you're going to see in the exam and how you should be learning for it. If you want to understand how to learn and organize through the idea of a chief complaint and its differential diagnosis, be sure to subscribe. I'm Dr. Philip Tisdall. I practiced for decades in mostly small hospitals with a very broad practice in pathology, which meant I saw everything in the lab, I saw everything in the ORs, I had private labs where we did all sorts of testings, built some research labs, and then in my 50s, I discovered this completely unsuspected love of teaching. And so I've spent well over the last decade interacting with students and trying to understand how better to get them thinking like a doctor so that you learn to love medicine and your exams, instead of being mountains that you dread, become opportunities for you to say, hey, I want to know if I learned this the right way, instead of worrying about whether you're passing or failing. I want to talk about patient-centered learning. That should be compared to subject-centered learning. Subject-centered learning is classical undergrad med. Physiology, anatomy, histology, microbiology, all of these subjects. And we all slavishly learn them, and we don't know why we're learning them, so we promptly forget them. That's really different than patient-centered learning, which is what you're going to see when you actually care for patients. And you can organize your learning of these basic sciences with patient-centered learning. And it all hooks on the idea of the chief complaint. Patients have a limited number of chief complaints that capture 80% of all the clinical encounters. And yes, they are in the clinical pathophysiology book in an index. A chief complaint is, yes, what the patient comes to see the doctor for. But it's more than that. A chief complaint is a very specific term that has a differential diagnosis. One of the mistakes students make is they try to do every conceivable disease that could cause that symptom. Yes, it just doesn't work. You get bogged down with far too long a list. When you're doing a chief complaint right, it has a differential diagnosis of 3 to 5, and that captures 80% of the possibilities. Once you start saying, I've got a chief complaint, say shortness of breath, it really narrows it down. It's heart or it's lung. And here's the benefit. That's the way doctors think. So when you start learning that way, you now flow with the story arc that all doctors use. And now you'll find when you go read questions, you're expecting what must follow. If I say shortness of breath, that question better start talking about heart or lung fast, or A, you've got the wrong chief complaint, or B, it's a really bad question. And I assure you, When you get to these big exams, step one is a great exam. Every student that I've ever talked about the experience with has said, it's a really good exam and the questions are really fair. And I say to them, what do you mean by fair? And they all say, even the questions I got wrong, I recognized I should have known. It's written by clinical doctors, and clinical doctors think chief complaint differential diagnosis. So once you start organizing all of your learning that way, not only can you follow the conversation, you know what has to come next. If I say chest pain, you know it's got to include pleuropericardium, heart, and chest wall. It's got to. That's the differential diagnosis. So come and start reorganizing how you're learning. We're not getting rid of any of the information that you're learning. It's all the same information. Instead, what it's going to do is it's going to let your brain match the brain of the doctor that writes the question so that you can follow the discussion and anticipate exactly what must be true. So that by the time you get to the question, you say, it's got to be that question because there's nothing else that would make sense. And students that come back having built their brain and knowledge around chief complaint differential diagnosis say, I really read the questions like stories now. And it's really quite fun and it all makes sense. And you got to tell me, doesn't that sound better? Let's talk about what a chief complaint is. When you're getting taught by your internists and your surgeons, they're all going to tell you that's what the patient comes in and complains of. I want to change that slightly for the medical student. I want to say to you, a chief complaint is a well-understood term in medicine from which you can develop a differential diagnosis. What are the possible causes of that symptom, sign, or test finding? Let's just do a practical example. Everyone can do heart. So let's just say a patient comes in with shortness of breath. Now watch what I'm going to do. I'm not going to give you a list of diagnoses. That's just not the right way to go about it. Instead, what we're going to start with is this. If I say shortness of breath, how many organ systems could that be? This is a way better discipline than getting a bunch of darts and throwing them at the diagnosis side. Let's do this and develop it so you learn. Once you're really good as a resident, you can jump straight to the diagnoses, but not when you're learning. So when I say shortness of breath, which organs could it be? Heart or lung? Then from the organ, we say which family of pathophysiology it could be. So in heart, that would be left ventricular congestive heart failure. Let's follow that. What subfamilies could that be? 80% of congestive heart failure is ischemia, valves, or hypertension. Great. Let's take valves. Do we have subfamilies of that? Sure. It's all going to be mitral or aortic, and it's going to be stenosis or regurg. So that when I say to you, an 88-year-old guy comes in with shortness of breath, and you can follow it through from left ventricular failure to valvular disease to aorta to stenosis, now you've got a specific diagnosis, aortic stenosis. And I promise you, when you do the 50 to 60 really critically important chief complaints for medical students, the world makes sense. So why does this matter for step one? If you're in exam prep, you have to put yourself in the mind of the examiner. And it's a clinical exam, meaning it's written by people like me that are coming out of clinical practice. We all start with a patient encounter. A patient walks in the room and has a chief complaint. We look for the chief complaint because we can form a differential diagnosis. Well, the second you know that, this is 3/4 of your questions on step. Right off the top, you know when a 68-year-old woman presents to her doctor's office, you go, got it, I'm waiting for the chief complaint. And when you find it, guess what? It's a very specific differential diagnosis. All doctors use this. It's how doctors think. So you can appreciate if you start learning all your information with chief complaint and a differential, suddenly you're organizing it the way clinical doctors approach patient care, and now you're not translating your questions. You're reading a story. And so just like we know that the bad person is going to get justice and the good person is going to escape after a series of hair-raising adventures, so I can promise you when someone comes in with shortness of breath and you think heart disease, you're now waiting for all of the risk factors and signs and symptoms to tell you, yes, we're in left ventricular congestive heart failure. And your questions now make sense. they read as stories, your anxiety drops, you know how you're going to organize what you're learning, and you're going to take this terrible anxiety about your test, and you're going to look forward to say, good, check and see if I know it. It's a very different experience. Let's talk about the commonest mistakes students make with this. When you start learning about chief complaints, you have to accept the discipline that it's hard work. When I was writing the book, because I don't come out of all the areas of clinical medicine, I practice my chief complaints and differential diagnosis. Students think that I magically can just pull it off the top of my head. No one can do that. You have to practice. That's the first common error I see. The second common error I see is that when you're first starting out, you have this deep desire to find a hook. Oh, I got it. It's a woman with cough, shortness of breath, and she's African-American, so it's going to be sarcoid. It doesn't work like that. She's got shortness of breath and a cough. You've got to say, what organ system is that? Don't start just shotgunning diagnoses. Medicine doesn't work like that, and I promise you, STEP and the other important exams know this. They don't tell stories to give you a hook, ever. They tell you stories to say, if you were standing in the hall with me as my medical student, you should listen to me talk to you as a junior doctor. I would say to you, I've got a 33-year-old African-American woman who hasn't been feeling well. She's got this little bit of cough. Why don't you go in and evaluate her and come back and tell me what you found? That's how you should read every question. It's a clinical exam. Once you go to the book and you realize there's these 50 to 60 chief complaints and you got to do the differentials, yeah, repetition matters. If you want to put them on cards and say shortness of breath, chest pain, abdominal pain, edema, perfectly fine. There's lots of boring moments in life. You're on the subway home. Get out your cards and practice them. Case studies are always written about this. If you want to see how doctors do this, go to serious journals and read their case reports and just marvel at how it's always this. Other things you can do, multiple choice questions. Good multiple choice questions demand that you follow the discussion, not look for some buzzword or hook that's going to bail you out. You're never going to get it. So there's lots of ways of practicing it. Frankly, the best way is to do patient care. But let's face it, that's not going to happen in a way that's volume enough for you to do. I think the really best way, after you've been practicing your cards and you think you're getting the hang of it and you've done some cases and it worked great, come and talk to me. That's what we do. You know, I talk to students all the time and we start with, hey, what did you see this week? Or what were you thinking about? Or you didn't get this question. And we just start talking and you realize these are all stories. You all know how Little Red Riding Hood works. Well, I promise you, left ventricular congestive heart failure, you just haven't heard it as many times as you heard your fairy tales. But once you've heard it enough times, it's just, you know where the plot goes and it's always the same. And boy, does that make things easier. Okay, so how should you go about it? Well, first of all, you have to understand you do have to do chief complaints and differentials. That's a major breakthrough if you just understand that. How often do you have to do it? The answer is way more often than you think. Do you think that world-class pianists get up after a major concert and practice their scales the next morning? Oh, yes, they do. I mean, I've done this all my life and I wrote the book. And before I do any course, you know what I do? I go and practice them all. I'm going to go do a little endocrine review. Yeah, I sat down 2 days ago and reread all of my chapters on endocrine and was delighted at how much I learned from myself from 3 years ago. If you looked at my desk right now, I've written all the key algorithms for endocrinology. I've done them countless. You couldn't count the number of times. And here I am sitting at my desk practicing them today. So yes, you do it a lot. No, you never get to quit. Yes, you carry them with you. It's no different than if you're playing a sport. Do you just go back and practice the elements of it? Yes, you do. There's no easy way to do this. You just got to put in the time. But the reward you get is when you then go and do a patient discussion with your mentor. When you do a multiple choice question on UWorld and you go, well, that makes perfect sense. When you go to a case study and can anticipate what the next discussion is going to be, because it has to be for the differential diagnosis. Performance equals talent times effort times directed effort squared. If you're a great memorizer, you can get to 70%. But if you want to take all the misery out, If you want it to translate into every aspect of medicine, that effort squared is learning how to do chief complaints and differentials, and differentials are built on pathophysiology. Remember, you can't teach yourself how to do this. You have to come to a community of people that are learning from someone like me that spent a lifetime of doing it in practice and then teaching you so he knows how medical students learn. So be sure to subscribe. I've taught for so long now that you find you're repeating the message again and again and again. And so finally, you write it all down. Several years ago, I just wrote clinical pathophysiology. So now what I can do when I teach, I can say to you, here's how I want you to approach this chapter. Then you can go learn all my images, all my thoughts, everything you do. It's written in a really cheerful, friendly format. So if you want your copy of the book, be sure to click the link in the description. So if you want more of this right now, go to my earlier video on Embrace the Suck. And in it, I explain to you, this isn't easy. It's just worth it. Next week, I'm going to be talking about this fundamental idea that clinical medicine is built on a foundation of basic medical sciences. And I'm going to have to teach you what that means. I'll see you there.